Hello, Clay County. Great to be back. I think we were here last time in May, I believe. Last time I didn't get to see the two bald eagles out there, so that's really cool. Michael talked about his dad being a minister, and I know I'm last, and one of the things I learned in the military was never be the one standing between people and the food. So I'm not going to take 15 minutes, but I'll tell you, we had a minister who was known for his lengthy sermons, and I grew up in southern Indiana, actually, in a small Methodist church, and in the lobby, they had pictures of military veterans on the wall in the lobby. And one day, a young boy was out there looking at the pictures, and his grandfather came up, and the boy said, "Grandpa, what are all these pictures?" He said, "Well, those are all men that died in the service." And he said, "Oh, 9:30 or 11. So I'm not taking it to you. So I'm seeing Woodsmall running for Congress, obviously. I'm running because I think we need to make America think again. We are going in the wrong direction. One of the other lessons I learned in the military, I'm a retired Air Force officer also. One of the things I learned in the military was if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. We have a lot of people in D.C. that are part of the problem. We need people that can go there to be part of the solution. I'll tell you a couple stories. And the one that probably affected me the most was about a month ago. I did a meet and greet in Mills River. And we took some questions, and there were a couple of young men up in the front row, and one of them raised his hand. He looked to be about 12, 13 years old. He raised his hand, and I thought, well, that's really cool. You've got somebody in the middle school age that's coming to a meet and greet and wants to ask a question of the candidate. It was really cool. I was very excited about it. I said, "Okay, what's your name?" "This is David." "Okay, David, what's your question?" I was just really looking forward to this. And David said, he's 12 years old. And David said, "I don't feel safe when I go to school. What can you do about that?" And I think about David every day. And I think about people that can't solve that problem in Washington, D.C. because they don't know how to frame the problem. The bad guys are doing a better job of framing the problem as a Second Amendment issue. It's not a Second Amendment issue. That's a problem that we could have fixed a long time ago. We should have fixed it a long, long time ago. But we've got to frame it for what it is, and that is a public safety issue. And so when your Republican friends out there say, "Well, you Democrats are just trying to take away my Second Amendment rights and take away my guns," tell them, you know what, that's a lie. Nobody's ever said that. We're not trying to take away all your guns. We're trying to keep kids safe. First day of school this year, we're doing that. Walmart sells bulletproof backpacks. That's not the America I grew up in. That's not the America I want my grandkids to grow up in. We've got a commander-in-chief that's mentally ill. My wife and I have a son in the Middle East right now. She had a rough 24 hours. He finally got through to his wife, and he's in a good place. He can't tell us where he is, but he's in a good place. But I think about all my military brothers and sisters over there and what they're going through, and we have a lack of leadership in Washington, D.C. We've got to get checks and balances back into government. You have to have representatives who understand the oath of office. I took the oath of office several times in the Air Force. And it requires that we support and defend the Constitution of the United States, not the president, not the party, not the Freedom Caucus. The Constitution of the United States. And our representatives, particularly the one that we have now, is derelict in his duty because he is loyal to the wrong thing. And people like that need to go. And until we get checks and balances back in government, we're going to continue to have this problem. That's why we've got to keep the House. We've got to flip the Senate. And we got to put a Democrat in the White House in 2020. So, along that line, I will just tell you a little bit of biographical stuff. I'm a retired Air Force officer. I worked in several government agencies as a contractor, the SEC and the FAA. I spent a couple of years managing a not-for-profit organization. I've been a corporate executive, and my last job before running was I was a coordinator for the business and leadership program at FAR College. I was there for about 3.5 years. I left there back in March, so I have a full year to run. The primary this year is going to be in March. So, as you know, we ran last time. Got in very shortly before the primary, just to run off by less than 1%. And a lot of people encouraged us to try again. So we said, well, we're going to give ourselves enough time to do it right this time. We're going to go out there and make sure we turn Western North Carolina Air Force Blue for 2020. we've been endorsed actually so far by the Mayor Pro Tem of Canton, Gail Mull. We've been endorsed by the Free Thought Equality Fund. We've been endorsed by State Senator Erica Smith, who some of you may know. She's running for U.S. Senate. Have you all had a chance to hear her?
Yes.
Very, very impressive. Very impressive woman. And just today, we got endorsed by Dr. Heather Hahn, who's the chair of the political science department at Marshfield University. So we're pretty proud of that. We're working on some others as well. Hopefully we'll have more to come there. So we talked about being part of the solution and not being part of the problem. The number one problem, in my view, and the number one issue that I want to fight when I go to Congress is getting money out of politics. Because as a management professional, we focus a lot on root cause analysis. What are the problems, but what are the root causes of those problems? And you can talk about climate, you can talk about guns, and you can talk about women's rights, and you can go right down the list of any issue you want to talk about. Why can't we get where we need to be on those issues? And it's the influence of big, dark money on our politicians that are making those laws. So until we attack that problem, we're not going to get as far as we need to be on those other issues. That is my number one goal, is to get the money out of politics. We need a constitutional amendment to overturn Citizens United and get this thing back where it needs to be. And go back to the one person, one vote philosophy, and get rid of gerrymandering and get rid of the Electoral College. Because it was made for 2016. That's why we had it in the first place, and it didn't work. So it's time for that to go as well. And so we need to get back to free and fair elections and get that folks money. That'll get us a long way toward fixing the health care issue and the climate issue and that sort of thing. Some of you may remember 2018, I wasn't smart enough to use the term Green New Deal. I think it's great, but I talked a lot back then about establishing jobs programs like the WPA and the Civilian Conservation Corps and doing that in terms of building infrastructure for green energy like windmills and water power and solar panels and that sort of thing. So I kind of had the same idea. I just wasn't smart enough to come up with a neat name for it. But I support that 100% because, you know, we got 8 grandkids and 1 on the way. And I think we're the first generation probably in history that's in a position not to leave this place better than we found it. And I think that's obscene. So we got to fix this environmental stuff. We got to get people in Congress, in the Senate, in the administration who are not spending time every day figuring out what environmental regulation they can roll back. I just saw they just looked at the 2020 defense budget, $738 billion, including $1.4 billion for a border wall, and over $9 billion for 90 fighter jets that the military doesn't need and doesn't want. That's roughly $10 billion. What could we do with $10 billion? And why couldn't we take some of that defense budget and focus on the real wars that we're fighting now, not with tanks and ships and planes, but with cybersecurity? That's where the real problem is going to be. Iran has that capability now, and we already know that they're going to meddle in our 2020 elections. And the Republicans in D.C. have fought against every law and every bill for election security that's going to pass. Where are they hiding? What are they afraid of? What they're afraid of is their gig is up. People know who they're for. They're for the big money. They're for the big donors. They're for the Russians. They're not for the people. The representative works for the people. I tell people all the time, campaigning is like a job interview, and you all are the hiring manager. So you've got to look at who's the best person for this job, who's the person that can win against whatever Republican comes out of the clown car in March, and there's 12 of them. I don't think it matters. I really don't think it matters. I think we're going to beat them. We've got a lot more level playing field this time. People are disenfranchised. Unaffiliated people are disenfranchised. A lot of Republicans are not happy with what's going on. They know it's time for a change. We've got to put somebody up there who can win in November and get this ship turned around. I think if you do your research, you'll see I have probably the most comprehensive, diverse background in terms of experience and education, master's in business, have a PhD in management, work in almost every sector. And my focus has always been solving problems. And that's working with people sometimes that you don't agree with, particularly in D.C. My grandparents, on my mother's side, my grandmother was a very staunch Republican. My grandfather was a very strong Democrat. And somehow they managed to reach across the aisle and work things out. I'm sure we can do that today also. But I want to go back to the community, the spirit, the neighborhood that we used to have when I grew up. My grandfather, when I was about in the third grade, lost his leg in a corn picker. And we lived in rural southern Indiana, 30 minutes from the hospital. By the time the ambulance got there and got him to the hospital, he lost all his blood. He lived. He got an artificial leg. But I remember during harvest season, he was in the hospital for months because of that. And I'll never forget it. It made a big impression on me as a young third grade boy. But farmers work, as you know, they work in long, long hours. And everybody in the county basically would work all day and bring in their corn and do their, you know, feed their cows and that sort of thing. And they would put the lights on the tractor and they would come over to our farm and they would finish picking the corn and taking it to the mill the next day. Now, that's what America is about, by helping each other, understanding what it means to be a community, understanding what it means to be a good neighbor. And we have the fighting spirit, like my grandfather. I'll never forget, I went to visit him in the hospital after his accident. And I didn't know what to say. I was very uncomfortable. I mean, you know, he just lost his leg. And he said, "Well, you know, Steve, I'm going to get an artificial leg, right?" "Okay. You know the first thing I'm going to do when I get the artificial leg? No, I'm going to kick your butt." I felt better. Because he's okay. He wanted to make sure that I knew he was okay. But that's the fighting spirit that we need. But we need to fight for the right things. We need to fight for those brown people coming across the border. We need to fight for women who should be able to make their own decisions about their health care. These are no-brainer things that are getting away from us. And your vote matters. So look at all five of us. 2 minutes. Two-minute warning. Take a look at all of us, and I got a lot of respect for everybody. No respect to his military service. How many vets do we have in this office? Thank you all for your service as well, by the way. We're all a little different. I just realized Michael talked about being the youngest one. I think I'm the oldest one. I'm not sure I feel about that. But as I asked George Burns once when he turned 100, how did you manage to live so long? He said, "Well, I was born a long time ago." And if I knew I was going to live this long, I'd have taken better care of myself. But I should have actually been refereeing high school basketball, so I'm 63 years old, and I can still beat the 18-year-olds down the floor. So that's got that going for me. I just heard for a little longer than that. So a couple minutes. Let's put people in Congress that really understand who they work for. They really understand what the job description is, which is the Constitution of the United States, and who care more about the people on Main Street than they do about the people on Wall Street. That's what it's all about. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for being good Democrats. Thank you all for what you do. I'm Steve Woodsmall. We've got letters over here at woodsmallfrenzy.com, and I look forward to talking to you afterwards individually. Do we have time for one?